All right, let's go ahead and begin today with a prayer. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this time to come together to grow in our understanding of where you're speaking to us. Help us, Lord, to discern more clearly your voice so that we can reject the voice of the enemy and that we may be surrounded by your voice of consolation, the voice which leads us and guides us into that which satisfies our heart. Give me, Lord, the words to speak which you wish me to speak. Give those the ears to hear the message which you wish them to hear. We ask all this through the intercession of the one who heard you best. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women. Blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, so today we are going to finish out our series on discernment of spirits. And so just kind of a recap of where we've been, and also for the theme of today, which I've titled The Tactics of Demons. If you look at the first two rules, which is what we covered the first class, which was 3 weeks ago, we talked about where side of the playing field do you find yourself on. And so that was what rules one and rules two were about, the playing field. Then you have the team book, or the voices that are present on the field of battle, on the field of spiritual warfare. And that's the voice of the enemy, which speaks in desolation. Again, distinguishing spiritual desolation, once again, from emotional desolation and physical desolation. So, but primarily when we're talking about desolation, we are speaking of spiritual desolation, not the type of desolation that comes from our interpersonal relationships with other human beings. Or likewise, things that come about because of a physical malady. But specifically spiritual desolation, which is when we feel a darkness within ourselves, or we feel far away from God, a decrease in faith, hope, and love, and actually what the voice of the enemy sounds like. These are all online. If you weren't able to make it to some of these, all these classes are online. You just have to go to the Good Shepherd website, go to the A.R.C. program, and you'll find the videos right there. We're also on YouTube. You can YouTube it. So therefore, you have the voices of the enemy, voice of the enemy, which is the voice of desolation. Again, recognizing the enemy is threefold, which actually you see kind of a hint of that in the gospel reading from today, which was all about spiritual warfare and temptation and Christ battling Satan in the desert. As the first point of the enemy is being the flesh, which is actually the strongest, our own brokenness and things of this nature, our own appetites. Then you have the world, which feeds into this, and likewise we live in a culture which feeds into that you can gratify and satisfy yourself and helps us in this. And then only thirdly do you find actually the notion of Satan and of demons and things of this nature. But at the end of the day, always remembering that Satan is the weakest of the three normally. Again, if you give him more power, he gains more power. But naturally speaking, Satan is the easiest to dismiss. And you see Jesus actually dismiss Satan at the end of today's gospel reading. But it says, and this is one of the things we'll talk about today, is that even at that, it says that Satan went away for a time. Which means also that Satan will come back. And likewise, he will consistently attack over and over again. But even though we understand that Satan is an angel and perfect, although fallen, is that Satan's tactics never really change. And so what we're going to be talking today a lot about is the tactics of the enemy. Because rules one and two was the playing field. Rules three and four, the voices on the playing field and how to distinguish between God's voice, which is conciliatory, voice of consolation, and the voice of the enemy, which is discouraging and which is desolation. And then we talked about what you do, actually, if you find yourself in desolation. That's what rules 6, 7, 8 were about. And then 9 was about what is it that causes desolation. What are the reasons why? And again, going back, it was laziness is one of the primary reasons why people will enter into it. Sloth, spiritual sloth or apathy, tepidity. Or it can be you're being tested, like Abraham or Job. Or it can be to avoid spiritual pride, being rule 9. And then rule 10, again, is that what do we do in the midst of consolation? What is our thought and what are we called to do? We're called to prepare. So as we start today off, these next rules, especially going with 12, 13, and 14, are all about the tactics. Before we get there, though, we get to rule 11. And rule 11 is this: let him who is consoled, so if you're in a state of consolation, so this is what you're called to do, see to humbling himself and lowering himself as much as he can, thinking how little he is able for in times of desolation without the grace of consolation. On the contrary, if you find yourself in desolation, what is it that you're called to seek? Think that he can do much with the grace, sufficient to resist all of his enemies, taking strength in his Creator and Lord. So a way you can understand Rule 11 is that this is the virtues, primarily the two virtues that a person should be seeking in these two states. And don't confuse the virtues you're called to seek. Well, that's what we're going to talk about in a second. Let one in consolation seek humility. So if you find yourself in a state of consolation where everything is good, your faith, hope, and love is okay, you feel that you are moving towards God, you can hear God, everything is, again, you have that voice of encouragement, which is predominantly surrounding you in your prayer life and things of this nature, is that the one thing you should actually be seeking in times of consolation is a greater growth in humility. Now let me distinguish humility from humiliation, because humility and humiliation are not quite exactly the same thing. Human beings will humiliate you. God will not. God will humble you. Because a humiliation is where we experience oftentimes starting in grade school and things like this, going through high school, into the job place, families and things like this. A person who will humiliate you will point out your fault and flaw and step on you so that they can raise themselves up, so they feel better. It's one of the reasons why we hate being humiliated, because it feels and it's an experience also of the injustice, although we might have deserved to be humiliated. But still, there's an evilness, in a certain sense, to humiliation, which is oftentimes with a malicious intent. Satan will humiliate you and actually will take great delight in humiliating you. God does not humiliate us, but God does humble us. If we find ourselves in a state of pride, he will want to bring us back into right relationship with him, which is that we don't believe that we are garbage, but we also believe that we are capable of much, that we find ourselves small but precious in the eyes of God. And so that's why if you find yourself in a state of consolation, the primary virtue, and that's what Rule 11 is about, what's the primary virtue you should be seeking? If you're in a state of consolation, you should be seeking humility, which is finding your worth in the eyes of God, which means that God might point out faults and flaws. But this is not a bad thing. St. Paul says in the New Testament, referring back to the Old Testament, which is a very frequent theme, is that God truly loves us, he will correct us. A loving father corrects his son. Actually, St. Paul will go so far as to say, this is proof. If you get corrected by God, this is proof of God's love for you. Because if you were an illegitimate child, via a bastard, is actually what he said. If you were an illegitimate child does not get the discipline of his father. An illegitimate child is either given everything to get him out of the face or they're given nothing whatsoever. A real father disciplines his sons, that's what St. Paul says, or daughters. And so within this, even when God corrects us, though, it is from an encouraging standpoint. And this is where especially contrition and conversion comes in, because God does correct us for our mistakes. But it's never where he places in our mistakes and our faults and our weaknesses as obstacles for growth. Remember going back to consolation, he takes away obstacles. He says, yes, you screwed up, but I still love you, and you can do better. Yes, you screwed up, but you can be free of this. Just make these small steps. That's why actually when people come to me in confession and they confess all of their sins, and this is oftentimes a very common thing many priests will do, they'll ask you, what's the one thing that you feel the worst about? Because usually actually God will not overwhelm you with all your sins. He'll make you aware of them, but he'll actually ask you to focus on one or two at a time. Because you can work on one or two at a time. And actually if you work on the ones that are more primary and core, as opposed to working on all these other things out here, but you work on the ones that are really feeding the issue, you actually might find the solution to all these different problems out here. For instance, one thing that a lot of people, especially younger people, will confess a lot is the sin of lust. And that's why, to a certain extent, when people come to me with the sin of lust and they confess lust and things associated with lust because there's a lot of shame there and they feel really bad about it, and then they'll kind of go through this and they'll spend a lot of time there. Or they might just go completely real quick through that to get it through over as fast as they want. Then they'll go and move the other stuff that they don't consider as important. And then, like all here, and then they'll drop, and I was jealous, and I gossiped. Well, actually, the jealousy and the gossip is actually more dangerous than the lust. The lust is not good, but the jealousy and the gossip, actually, that goes to self-identity problems. If you have a problem with especially jealousy, where you don't feel loved, and therefore you have to have what other people want, if you actually find your own sense of identity in the Lord, is that this actually, you're okay. It doesn't lead you into jealousy and things like that, which actually, if you don't feel okay about yourself, it oftentimes will lead you into acts of lust. Does this make sense? So that's why actually when the Lord tells us to work on things, he usually, and we might think that we need to work on this, but the Lord will say, no, I want you to work over here. I want you to work on this thing over here. So the Lord does humble us, and that's why we should seek humility in times of consolation, but also recognize then that when God points out our sins, it's always in an encouraging fashion. That's why if you ever get, and then the Lord can speak in prayer. He can do this through spiritual direction, through a confessor. If you ever get a confessor who is not charitable, you can always go to a different confessor. If you don't find a confessor who's the voice of encouragement and consolation, then just seek out another one. That's why there's certain people who like different confessors. That's why it's up to you to kind of find someone. But I would say you should probably try to find a confessor that you try to stick to, again, for the most part, because that's where the confessor will get to know you. And this is actually very important for Ignatius. It's also very important for many people who don't have the time for regular spiritual direction and like that. But what you do have time for is regular confession, because we offer it every single week. Does this make sense? And so confession is not meant to be a counseling session, but it is meant to be a way in which you grow and you're being called constantly into conversion, because confession will also call you. That's why you shouldn't just wait until the last minute for something really bad, but regular confession can be a really wonderful way in which a person is constantly humbling oneself. That's why I try to go to confession at least every 6 weeks. Actually, I end up probably going more. But I try to go, again, my rule of thumb is that after 6 weeks, I can find my anxiety level, my personal one, rising tremendously. Things that don't normally irritate me really irritate me. Again, and after the things that always irritate me will cause me to explode, like driving on the road. But after, if I haven't been in confession a while, that's what I've started to notice, is that if there's not been a constant state of especially entering into the humbleness of the sacrament of confession, is that I will find anxiety as well as stress rising exponentially. And so within the state of consolation, humility, again, recognizing that the only reason why we're there is because it's a gift. If we are there, is actually many people are not experiencing this, and so we are there because we have other people have oftentimes helped us to get there, so we've not earned consolation. Humility is something which, again, management, not necessarily that it has to be from fear, but otherwise we fall into the trap of St. Peter, who thinks that he can do it all himself. Jesus, I can follow you wherever you go. No, you can't. Yes, I can. No, you can't. Yes, I can. You're going to fall 3 times, Peter. And the reason for this is because Peter doesn't yet have the Spirit. He doesn't even know what he doesn't have. Because until he has received the Spirit, he doesn't know the difference. But when the Spirit is given to Peter, he's able to be courageous versus before. But what Peter, to a certain extent, not in a malicious way, but in a very kind of a narcissistic way, just like a natural human narcissism, he thinks he can do it himself. And therefore he finds himself fallen and in desolation after he has to abandon Christ in the garden or in the courtyard. So you cannot presume to be working upon your own energies, even in times of consolation. That's why we just recognize that if this is where we are, it's wonderful, but we should be seeking to humble ourselves. That's the primary virtue that you seek. The attitude in consolation is a humble heart, recognizing that God is in control. We are in control of almost nothing. And actually, when you actually surrender control to God, really surrender, it brings you freedom. Brings you a tremendous sense of freedom and an experience of freedom, because you recognize, okay, actually, the understanding of control is that a control, for the most part, is actually an illusion. You can't even control your eyes not blinking. Okay, we control almost nothing. Some people think that they can control their faith. You can't control your faith, hope, and love. Your faith, hope, and love is in God's hands. You can control your cardinal virtues, which is temperance, justice, prudence, and fortitude, but you have no control over your theological virtues of faith, hope, and love, by which the cardinal virtues stem from. So the primary virtue to be seeking in times of consolation is the humble heart. And this is something which you have to seek because, in naturally speaking, because of sin and concupiscence, naturally speaking, we are not humble. Again, in the garden, yes. But as a consequence of sin, we naturally speaking suffer. Every single sin can always be stemmed back to the sin of pride in some fashion or form. And therefore, the person who is really in a state of consolation will be constantly being called to be humble. But at the same time, God will not humiliate us. And so if you find something to be humiliating, now then that's why you have to sometimes also pray and think about the distinction. What are those times where I've been humiliated? And what were the times where I was humbled? We don't always like being humbled, because our pride and our flesh, especially the flesh, will rear back. That's the primary thing which fights against humility, is the flesh. The flesh will fight back against humility. But if we actually become aware, you can become aware very quickly of the difference between humility and humiliation. Because God desires us to be humble. He does not desire us to be humiliated, because if you get humiliated too often, you end up with no self-esteem whatsoever, which can lead you very quickly into envy. Does this make sense? That's why pride and envy are like the flip sides of the same coin. A person with extremely low self-esteem versus a person with a bloated self-esteem. So it's something which we naturally speak, and that's actually why praying actually, the wonderful thing about praying for humility, if you really pray for humility, you understand it correctly, you are praying, Lord, help me decrease so that you may increase. But if you decrease, God will raise you up much higher than you ever thought possible. This is what Mary finds. Mary, by seeking the last place, is given the first place. By always seeking, again, humility, and that's what Mary expresses as a humble heart, she will always find actually freedom, as well as being raised up far beyond her wildest expectations. So within this, in times of desolation, you should not seek humility. Humility is not the primary virtue that you focus on in times of desolation. The primary virtue that you focus on in times of desolation, the storms, where we feel like we are drowning, you should not think about, because humility focuses upon, for the most part, I can't do it. I can't do it myself. I need other people. I need God. Things like this. I can't, right? So in times of desolation, if you try to be humble, or you're trying to focus in times, and you're still your primary focus in times of desolation is on humility, you will probably find yourself very quickly tired out and lethargic in your prayer life and in your spiritual life and things like this. The primary virtue to actually focus upon, this is where St. Ignatius will talk about, you reflect upon yourself in desolation. You try to be as objective as you can. You primary focus not upon your feelings. You can have focus on your feelings, yes, in times of consolation. Do not trust your feelings in times of desolation, because the enemy will, in times of desolation, will primarily work upon your feelings. You move into the rationale, your reasoning, your thinking. This is where the head protects the heart. Does this make sense? So within that, you primarily focus upon thinking and not feeling, and that's where you look at, again, those eternal truths. Going back to, remember, Rule 7 and 8, you focus on the eternal truths. With God, all things are possible. Those mantras where we train ourselves in times of desolation. But that's because even if you don't feel the grace, you do know it is there. What? God will never give you more than you can handle. This will pass. Or I will pass, but it will pass. It's going to pass. All things are transitory except heaven and hell. So realizing that the grace present is strong enough, and so actually the primary virtue that you focus upon if you find yourself in a time of desolation, just like a soldier, is fortitude. Fortitude and standing firm, that you do not budge. You do what you are called to do. And therefore, if you are focusing on humility, you're focusing on what you can't do. If you're focusing on fortitude, which is one of the cardinal virtues, you're focusing upon, no, I can do this. I can get my butt up and walk to the church, or drive to the church and go and do my holy. I can get up and take care of my family. I can do these things. Does this make sense? And this is where you'll find that this is the primary type of thinking that is very, very important to find oneself and be pursuing. This is the virtue to be pursuing if you're in a state of desolation, which is also why you must be aware. If you're not practicing any type of awareness practices, such as the examine or things like this, is that when you will never know you're in a state of desolation. But if you find yourself in a desolation, you should flip into your training, and your training says, I need to focus on fortitude until things get better. It's the same thing that a soldier does on the battlefield. Remember, this is written by a soldier. This is written by Ignatius, who recognizes who survives on battlefields and who does not. The person who sticks to their training and they are fortuitous and they hunker down behind their shield is the one who actually survives. The one who panics and starts changing the plan is the person who gets picked off and killed. And so the same principles which are true in physical warfare are going to be the same principles which are true in the spiritual warfare, because the physical reflects the spiritual. And so what he calls us to is a spiritual balance, which is why daily spiritual awareness is key and pivotal, is that you don't have a naively high expectation of yourself and therefore end up like Peter. It's also why you also don't have, though, a despairingly low, where you have no expectations of yourself. I can't do anything, okay? Is that you what? In times of consolation, that's why you make, in times of consolation, definitive choices on what you're going to do in your spiritual life. And that's oftentimes much more helpful if you're doing it in the context of with a spiritual director or a person who is a spiritual leader in your life. Because if you maintain spiritual battles, everything can be exploding. The universe can be exploding around you. You can be in the middle of a storm on the sea, but yet you can maintain your calm, which is what Jesus does in the middle of the crucifixion. Jesus never loses control of himself. Why? Because he is not in control. His Father is in control of him. He is what? He is in the hands of the Father. He is the master of his appetites and things like this. Does this make sense? So spiritual humility is what should be sought in times of consolation, fortitude in times of desolation, the two primary virtues that one should be seeking. Rule 12 is, now I'm going to, this is written in the language of the 15 and 1600s, and so it might be offensive at first. I will change the example. So, acts like a woman and being weak against vigor and strong will, because in some way when a woman is quarreling, a man lose heart. So I'm just going to move forward to avoid this, because the example will cause more problems. It's the truth of the example which is more important. So actually, this is what Timothy Gallagher told all of us when we were taking this retreat with him. And he said, if you want to do this in the future, he's like, just change the example. And there's a very good example, as opposed to using this kind of archaic male and female relationship, is that the principle is this, is that you stand firm in the very beginning. Because just like you, if anyone has ever recognized the grandchildren you might have, or your children you had, is recognizing this about the enemy is essentially weak. He's not essentially strong. This is not, going back to, again, those three levels, flesh, world, enemy of Satan. Satan is the weakest of the three. He is also the weakest of the three. His primary thing, that's what we think about. We always think about him being so strong. He's only as strong as we allow him to be. His primary thing, because this is not his sphere or his plane of reality. It's ours. He wants to take it. He desires that. Okay, but we don't have to give it to him. His primary focus is essentially weak. If you stand firm in the very beginning, is that Satan loses his power. He's not a monstrous beast that cannot be beaten, but he's actually rather weak and pathetic. That's actually what Michael, the angel, Archangel Michael, shows and demonstrates, is God's absolute power over evil. If you really understand what Michael demonstrates in both Jewish lore as well as within our Catholic faith, Michael shows that we do not believe in a yin and yang, a yin and yang which puts good and evil in equal balance. We are not dualists who believe that good and evil are fighting each other, and this is, you know, good crushes evil, period. Jesus comes as Christ the King who decapitates the serpent. Is that Jesus is the one who is strong, the enemy is the one who is weak, and he's a liar, and he tries to say that he is stronger than he actually is. When you really understand it, Michael, which means one who is like God, that's what the Hebrew word Michael means, is that when evil gets into a battle with good, it's crushed. Definitively, game over. It's not even a fight. And so actually the primary reality of the enemy is that it is primarily weak. And it is not a raging beast that cannot be killed. He is a chain dog who actually can't really do very much to you unless you allow him. And so within this, when you really understand the essential weakness, but this is also does not mean that he has no fangs. It's also why he's talked about in the scriptures as a serpent. Again, associated with one dragon, but also serpent as in what? Something which bites and leaves a poison. Again, it's actually pretty easy. If you really understand snakes, it's actually pretty easy to kill them. But if you're not careful with them, they will bite you. And they can what? Poison you and kill you. And the same thing is true of the enemy. He is essentially weak. That's why when people are like, the devil made me do it, and they feed, or when people think that the devil is working behind in the scenes of all things like this, no, they actually are feeding more energy, more power into him than not. And actually, when you recognize that he is essentially weak, the enemy is actually, and this is the better example in our modern day, is like a spoiled child. And this is the primary, actually, attitude of the enemy. Like a spoiled child, if you are... And children, although we love them and things like this, children are essentially weak as well, especially when confronted with their parents. But if you have a spoiled child, and if you've ever tried to reason with a spoiled child, okay, and you have a child who you know is spoiled, but then you what? You want to appeal, and you want them to learn, you want them to grow up, you want them to be good. But there's a certain time where if you start reasoning with a spoiled child, is that this is what will happen. They will get louder, and louder until they are actually controlling you. And you see this in grocery stores. Again, if you spoil, it's also why it says in the scriptures, spare the rod, spoil the child. Again, if you have false compassion on the child, you will destroy them. And this is true to children. But the enemy is actually, if you allow the enemy to play, if you feed into him, if you don't hit him right at the very beginning, is that he will turn into an uncontrollable monster. But if you actually are strong from the very beginning and you just don't allow it, which is also why you yourself have to know what your sins are. You yourself have to know where you are weak, where you are liable to get hit. Because if you don't know what your triggers are, triggers is the psychological term that we use for people who get triggered by certain things, but you get triggered in many different ways in a spiritual reality. We all have our particular sins that we all struggle with, and it's probably as unique to us as our personalities are. But see, if you know them, and you can recognize the signs of when the enemy is present, and that's why spiritual awareness is so, as soon as you get a hint or a glimmer, or, for instance, as soon as you start hearing that voice, which you know is the evil one, but it's so sometimes comforting to comfort. You want to comfort the child. Comfort the child. And remember that this is also the flesh. Okay, but you know this, and that's why recognizing the language, going back to rule number 3, recognizing the language of desolation, all, never, can't, won't, will never, universal language. That's why people get irritated with me all the time, because they'll say, well, Father Tom, it's always been. I said, always? And they're like, you know what I mean. I said, no, I don't. You just said always. And they're like, you know what I mean. Is it always this way? No, but it's mostly this way. Oh, that mostly is different than always. That's why precise language. Remember that the enemy is a being of language. Messenger, language, intellect, language. It is, for the most part, you use sloppy speech. This is what I had a professor in the seminary who said, sloppy speech, messy mind. Get you in trouble every time. Loved my favorite professor in the seminary. So if you recognize the signs of when the enemy is present and you hit it right at the beginning, you have no problem. Because if you're aware and you start to recognize the spoiled child, which more often than not lives within our own flesh, you're firm from the beginning and you say no. For instance, you can all of a sudden, you can be triggered also not just by a thought, you can be triggered by a feeling. Recognizing, again, affective awareness as well as intellectual awareness, aware of what's going on. You have a bad encounter at work, you know that you've responded badly into the past, and it brings up that feeling. Is that if you say, no, I'm not going to allow this. This is not about anything else. This is what? No. Does this make sense? So when you hit it from the very beginning, it actually doesn't become a problem. But as soon as you start feeding into the feeling, as soon as you start feeding into that thought, this person has always been a jerk, they've always done this, they're never going to change, so forth, what? Your mind starts spinning down the rabbit hole. But if you get it from the very beginning, and if you're firm from the very beginning, you don't give in, you stand firm, you put him in his place, which actually more often than not is us. You put yourself, you allow the Holy Spirit, you allow God to place your flesh and the evil one in its place, is that you will find that the spoiled child becomes much more manageable. Does this make sense? Because this is actually in understanding the tactics. If you have a weak enemy, okay, that weak enemy, if it's not stupid, is going to use every advantage that it has. And one of the primary advantages that the enemy has is illusion. Again, being a spiritual being, being a non-physical being and things like this, its primary tactic is illusion. And one of the greatest illusions that it has is itself, is a thing that it tries to make itself out to be. But when you take away the illusion, it becomes much more easy to fight. Does this make sense? Because that's the primary tactic. And again, it's the same thing which happens even in the world today in terms of tactics in the world today. Even in terms of ISIS and things like that. They try to make themselves seem like they're much bigger and badder and scarier and things like that. And they work upon fear. It's also why one of the primary tactics of the enemy is fear. If you find yourself in a state of fear, that is not God. Fear of the Lord is called awe. It's not terror. If you find yourself in a state of fear, this is not God speaking to you. If you find yourself in a state of anxiety, God takes away anxiety. Anxiety is always a clear mark of the enemy. fear is always a clear mark of the enemy. And that's very present throughout all of Scripture. So that's why next time you experience fear, then the question becomes, what am I experiencing fear about? Processing it. I'm feeling fear, awareness. What am I feeling fear about? Oh, it's about temporal reality. It's about things that, okay, these are things that are important, but I'm pouring all of this energy into this. And this might, I might not even lose my job. It's a fear. What? That's why emotional, especially or relational things, can lead you to spiritual. Lord, why are you going to take my job away? Does this make sense? Or my finances and things like that? Nope, I'm worried about money. In the grand scheme of things, you know what? The happiest people in the world are some of the poorest. And I might not lose anything anyways. Almost all of our fears are of unfounded fears that never happen. But what? The enemy uses fear. It is an agent of fear. That's why the mark of fingerprints, the lingering fingerprints of the enemy is always fear and anxiety, because through fear and anxiety, he can control. Does this make sense? It's also why our Father talks about what? Free us from anxiety and things like that, or at least within the old rite when we had it in Matt. Again, if you don't start at the very beginning, though, if you play into it and pander it, and you is that you will have a monster. This is why if you see Jesus in the temptation, which we saw in the gospel reading today, Jesus is very firm, very clear, very concise from the very beginning. He gets hit, he hits back. But he hits back not violently, he hits back with truth. Nope, man does not live, you can make these into bread. Nope, man does not live on bread alone. End of conversation. This is the enemy. Awareness, knowledge, rejection. Does that make sense? That's what I'm talking about. Awareness, what is going on. Knowledge, nope, this is not true. Reject the enemy. This is where we get into these next rules are all about how do you reject and how do you recognize what you're called to reject. You are called to reject fear. Always. Anxiety, always. If you are being ruled by fear and anxiety, you will make very, very poor decisions. So, again, fear and anxiety can also try to say that it's prudence. It will try to say, no, I'm being prudent. No. You have to look into, is this causing disturbance? Is this deep down? Is this affecting you on a deep affective level? Is this causing turmoil, a storm? Does this make sense? That's why being aware of the deep, what's going on deeply within ourselves. Or what does turmoil look like in terms of if it's on the level of the mind? In terms of on the heart, on the level of the affect, turmoil will look like anxiety, okay? Fear, tensing up in the body, things like that. Can anyone imagine what it looks like if it's an attack on the level of the mind? Confusion, as opposed to knowledge. Things are just really confusing. This doesn't make sense. But yet, it seems like this. I mean, it has to be this way. Confusion, bad reasoning, bad thought, there's not cohesion. Does that make sense? So confusion, actually, you can find people who are just in states of confusion. They're just like, I don't know, but everything is uncertain. That's why relativism and the danger of relativism as a philosophy. Is everyone familiar with relativism? Relativism is that this is your truth, and that your truth is your truth, my truth, my truth, that's your good, and this is my good. There's no universal good, truth, or beauty that orders all of reality. And so that's why, actually, if you buy into the philosophy of relativism, you are going to very quickly find yourself in a state of confusion, because it's the absence of objective truth. So within this, but when you recognize discipline and firmness are needed when you are combating the enemy, and this is why discipline and firmness, not just on the level of telling the devil no, but also controlling the appetites. It's one of the first things that Jesus shows in the temptation of the desert. He is not controlled by his appetites. The appetite for food, the appetite for sex, the appetite for fame, the appetite for company. There's times where he even tells people no. He walks away from people and goes off to pray. So he tells the apostles, and then they come out seeking him. Jesus flees sometimes into retreating away from people. Because what? He can say no to relationships. He can say no to things because at times he needs to be with his Father. That's why he doesn't just allow, because not just the physical, fleshly appetites, it can be the emotional appetites and things like that. So, strength with the enemy is that you recognize that he is primarily weak. If he is weak, he will lose heart. Because once he finds himself rebuffed, He will go away for a time. So he loses heart, he will flee, as well as that he will cease his temptations, but only until the next attack. So you might have a few moments, but there might be actually times where you might find yourself constantly under attack throughout the entirety of the day in terms of things like this. And that's why you constantly, if you train your mind to recognize and be aware, you can constantly reject it throughout the entirety of the day, and you can actually find yourself in a consistent state of peace, even in the middle of being constantly under attack. Does this make sense? So in evaluating and then moving forward, the 13th rule is this, when also looking at the tactics of the enemy, especially how the evil one presents himself and what he actually is. The 13th rule, likewise, the enemy acts as a licentious lover in wanting to be secret and not revealed. For as the licentious man who, speaking for an evil purpose, solicits a daughter of a good father or a wife of a good husband, wants his words and persuasions to be secret, the contrary pleases him, displeases him very much. When the daughter reveals to her father or the wife to her husband his licentious words and depraved intentions, because he easily gathers that he will not be able to succeed with the undertaking begun. In the same way, when the enemy of human nature begins his wiles and persuasions of the just soul, he wants and desires that they be received and kept in secret. When one reveals them to a good confessor or to another spiritual person that knows his deceits and evil ends, it is very grievous to him, because he gathers from his manifest deceits being discovered that he will not be able to succeed with his wickedness begun. So let's open that up, what that actually means. This is also where confession really, really is helpful, and why Jesus gives a commandment for confession and why the sacrament of confession is so important. So why a lot of people don't recognize the reality of why naming and speaking your sins is so actually helpful. Not just psychologically, because you get it off your chest, but it's actually very helpful because it goes into this 13th rule. So the enemy's desire, like every, again, licentious lover, as same as he says, and we all know that this still exists in the world today. Again, you might have seen it with your teenage girls or with things or with married women. That's why he goes out and uses those examples. No lover, illegitimate lover, wants to be known publicly, because especially from the very beginning. If he's known, everyone will attack him, and likewise will be driven out. He has to stay. The longer he can stay secret, the longer he can stay unknown, the more that he can take control of this person's heart. So eventually they'll turn against everyone who is telling them one thing. Does this make sense? We've probably all seen it, or possibly even experienced it. People, again, who can seduce. That's actually why the scriptural word for Satan, more often than not, is the seducer. He seduces, and he seduces in a very seductive way, because the seductions of the enemy, and actually one of the greatest plays of our modern era probably perfectly demonstrates this, and this is the play The Phantom of the Opera. And if you know The Phantom of the Opera, what? He does not want to be revealed. He has to stay in shadows, because if he comes out into light, all of his evil will be made manifest, and people will recognize him. All of his power actually also lies in deception, being in shadows, and things like this. Although the music is beautiful, I love the music. But it is a fascinating, fascinating film if you look at it on a spiritual level, on the level of spiritual warfare and things like this. Fascinating. Because there's probably nothing else that I've actually come across in terms of media which actually depicts this 13th rule as well as that one. Desires not to be revealed. Desires to stay secret. Again, the secret kingdom, the pleasures, especially feeding on the fantasies. Even the language of the phantom is your fantasies, let your fantasies unwind in the music. Again, let darkness, again, all these different, let your dark side come out. All these different things that come about. Is that he wants to stay secret, because if these things are spoken publicly, they would never happen. If they actually are spoken of, especially very quickly, they will very quickly be curtailed by people who know better. And so within this, the primary thing that the enemy wants is these things to be said and to be spoken in silence, and he wants you to keep them in silence as well. Don't talk about them. Reveal them to no one. This is far too shameful. This passion, this feeling you had, this thought you had, you might have thought about cutting someone's head off. And you're like, I can't reveal that to anyone because you're so angry or something like that. I can't. It's too shameful. It's too horrible. No. Go to confession and confess it, please. Because the priest will say, you might actually hear from the priest, I've thought that too. I wanted that person in particular. Is that, but you know what? We don't do that. We control those darker impulses. And you can actually laugh about it. Exactly. It's actually what the enemy also hates. I'll just tell you, the enemy hates to be laughed at. The evil one hates to be mocked. He loves to mock. He does not like to be mocked. Why? Because he's prideful. He's arrogant. A humble person doesn't mind being laughed at. A humble person can laugh at themselves. But an arrogant person does not like to be laughed at. And there's no one more arrogant than the enemy. And so within this, the desire to remain silent, and these are the things you cannot, these are internal dialogue that oftentimes people will have, and they'll think, well, this is just my own internal dialogue. Nope, you're always in dialogue with someone. You're always in dialogue with someone. You're either in dialogue with God or with the enemy. There is no dialogue. We are never alone. Going back to Scripture, you are never alone. We are called to be in constant dialogue with God. That's what we were made for. We are temples of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit who wants to be with us constantly, not speak to us just in our 15 minutes in the day, but speak to us throughout the entirety of the day. Have, yes, intimate conversations, but also have casual conversations throughout the day as well. But the enemy will also, if you don't have the Spirit, will move into that. And so these are just some very common phrases that if you hear this internal dialogue going on, this is not the voice of God and this is not you. This is a spiritual attack. So you cannot speak about this to anyone. You cannot speak about your internal turmoil that's going on. Keep it secret. Shut down. Be invulnerable. Don't talk about it with other people. It's too shameful. People will never understand. You must not speak about this. And this is what we can feel. I don't feel I can talk about this to anyone. No, you can usually find someone you can talk about it with, even if you have to pay someone. Go. Yeah, but there's lots of people you can pay. You can always go to your priest for free. Sometimes people, I think, come to the priest for free counseling more than anything else, which is fine. But what? You can't speak about this. You can speak about this. You can speak about anything else, but don't touch this one issue. Don't talk about that thing over there that happened 20 years ago that you are humiliated about, that you have never done again, but this thing over here, it's part of you. Don't talk about it with anyone. What? You can talk about anything else, but not this issue. Have anyone felt that way? I have. Again, you can talk about anything, just don't talk about this. If you talk about this, this person will never understand you, or they'll judge you. The person's going to judge me if I talk about that. Sound common? Again, this person will be shocked that you could be so weak that you would feel such things in your heart. They will lose their esteem for you. They'll lose your love for you if you reveal this and talk about this. Does this make sense? Another one. This person will never, if you reveal this, if you talk about this to this person will not want to be with you anymore. This happens very often, especially in marriages. People stop and break down in communication, break down in speaking to their spouse about what's really going on. Again, I'm not saying that you have to talk about everything because that requires a deep relationship in marriage, but actually you're supposed to be in marriage. The idea of marriage is that you have someone that you can really reveal the entirety of your heart to, and that person is not going to judge you, but they will be, again, they might be critical, they might bounce things back. They're like, no, that doesn't work. No, that's not true. You are beautiful. You are good. You are capable of much, especially self-depreciating thoughts and things like that. But see, that's where we are called to be open and honest, and that's why we have to have at least one or two people that we can go to always and really bounce these things off of. But also you have to have the right person. Because another one, which is the mark of the enemy, the person will criticize you. They're going to laugh at you. Again, and will confirm your fears about your spiritual inadequacy. If I tell people I don't know how to pray. If I tell people I don't feel like I've ever prayed. If I tell people God's never spoken to me. And everyone else, God speaks to everyone else. But I really don't feel like God's ever spoken to me. But I'm in a prayer group. I've been in a prayer group for 10 years. And yet, I desire it, but I don't really feel it. Or I'm not, these types of things. But the shame that's accompanied with it, and therefore people don't talk about it. And therefore, it remains in darkness. This is not, if you hear that, don't talk about this. I can't talk about this. Or you feel it, that is not the voice of God. That is the voice of the enemy. This is the tactics of the enemy. He wants you to keep it secret. The licentious lover who wants to be stayed in secret, because the longer he has you in secret, the longer he can control your heart and your thoughts. And therefore, you will then discount everyone else who tells you something which is different. This will be unbearably painful. It's best to say nothing and to do what you can yourself to carry this burden. Carry your own cross. And they'll even, as we saw from this past week's reading, it'll twist Scripture. twist Scripture back on, pervert the real meaning of Scripture and twist it. Just as the Scripture, what? That's what Jesus is in the second temptation of Christ. The evil one, what? If you are really loved by God, if you're really the Son of God, prove it. If you're God your Father, you can throw yourself down and you will not have your foot cast against a stone. Will not crush it against a stone. And then Jesus comes right back. You shall not put the Lord your God to the test. Hits him right from the very beginning, but also, what? Speaks it aloud. So, in this, or you're too busy, too many other things, this is not important. Although, this is something which is, what, driving, and likewise, which is pushing, and you know that this is something which is pushing you. The problem's not that important, although we know it is, we can feel it, we can, because it's unbearable, and it's unbearable because we oftentimes don't talk about it. This is why St. Ignatius says, reveal them to a good confessor or to another spiritual person. So, what is he saying? That you reveal it, the confession, and this is where confession is extremely helpful. It's also why you have to name what's going on in confession. Because when you name it, and there have been points, I'll tell you, some of you might have experienced this from me. People will say certain things, and I'll even laugh. But I'm not laughing in a harsh way, but I'm just laughing. I'm like, no, that's not real. That's not accurate. Actually, if you've ever gone to confession, like you're terrified, and all of a sudden you walk out and you feel light. It's because, what, you actually are lighter, because there's things gone. And so within this, you reveal it to a proper confessor, to a proper spiritual person, a person who you know is wise and holy, a person who you know is, and actually St. Ignatius says this, if I had a choice between a person who is well-trained versus well-intentioned and love the Lord, I would choose the person well-trained. That's what Ignatius says. I would choose the person well-trained because well-intentioned people can very easily lead you astray. Go to a good confessor or another spiritual person. And this doesn't have to be a priest. It can be just someone who you know and you trust. This is why godparents is actually a very important role in people's lives. It's something which is not really taken seriously, but that's what a godparent is meant to be. Does this make sense? That's why actually even in the structure of the sacraments that these things are built into the sacraments, that if we really appreciate them and they don't just jump through the hoops, this can be actually ways in which we find a person that we can go and be our spiritual confidant. So within this, St. Therese talks about one day, is that Therese, the little flower, and these are just young pictures of her, St. Therese talks about how one day, and this is her own words, the beautiful day of my wedding vows finally came. This is when she was making final vows, final procession to give her entire life to the Lord for the rest of her life. It was without a single cloud. However, the preceding evening, a storm arose in my soul, the like of which I'd never seen before. She said, not a single doubt concerning my vocation had ever entered my mind until then, and it was evidently was necessary that I experience this trial. In the evening, while making the way of the cross, after matins, after evening prayer, she was doing the stations, my vocation appeared to me as a dream, a chimera. What does that mean? All of a sudden, her vocation, her feeling of her vocation just evaporated. She's like, oh, and like it appeared to be what? A chimera. I found my life in Carmel, the monastery, to be very beautiful, but the devil inspired me with the assurance that it wasn't for me, and that I was misleading my superiors by advancing on this way to which I wasn't called. The darkness was so great that I could understand one thing only. I didn't have a vocation. This is right before she makes final vows. How can I possibly describe the anguish in my soul? It appeared to me, and this is an absurdity which shows it was a temptation from the devil, that if I were to tell my novice mistress about these fears, she would prevent me from pronouncing my vows. So what? Now you don't think you have a vocation. The person who helps you determine that, you're not going to tell. But I can't tell you because then I won't get my vocation. That doesn't work. Confusion. She finds herself in a state of confusion, okay, about these fears. She would prevent me from pronouncing my final vows. And still I wanted to do God's will and return to the world rather than remain in Carmel. She's willing to leave the monastery right then. And if God was calling me out, I wanted to leave the world. And I would go back to the world. I would leave the monastery even though this is what I really wanted. I made the novice mistress come out of the choir. And filled with confusion, I told her the state of my soul. Fortunately, she saw things much clearer than I did, and she completely reassured me. The act of humility I had just performed put the devil to flight, since he had perhaps thought that I would not dare admit my temptation. My doubts left me completely as soon as I finished speaking. Again, look at those. My doubts left me completely as I finished speaking. As soon as she's named them, is that all of a sudden all of this different oppression came off of her. Nevertheless, to make my act of humility even more perfect, I still wish to confide my strange temptation to our mother Prius, who simply laughed at me. Is that what? What she was told? You have, out of everyone here, Teresa, you're the one who I'm most confident about. You have nothing to fear. And what, the affirmation, the verbal affirmation, took away all of her anxiety. Does this make sense? But just imagine for a moment, again, the morning of September of 8th, I felt as though I were flooded with a river of peace, and in this peace which surpasses all understandings, I pronounced my holy vows. Now imagine for a moment if she had not told anyone. She could have carried this oppression the entirety for the rest of her life, gone through it from a sense of obligation, always felt that maybe it wasn't for her. If she revealed it to the proper, if she didn't ever talk about it, she just went through vows and didn't talk about it. She could have actually had an unnecessary burden. And this is what some people think, well, that's the cross. That's not the cross. This is the oppression, to try to steal joy, because then she wouldn't have been the bright light that she was. Because if the devil can't kill you, can't get you over to his side, he will try to snuff you out. That's what he was trying to do to Therese. And so within this, if she had not told anyone, she could have actually for years carried this unhealthy burden, a burden from the enemy. Or if she had told the wrong person, imagine if she had told another person who was parallel to her, a friend, another one of the novices, or a person who was below her, one of the persons who just entered in first year. She could have actually possibly done damage to that younger person. And she might have heard, well, you know what, I felt the same way. Maybe we should both leave. Okay, you go to the wrong person, you will get bad advice. What? Not necessarily that they're the devil. You'll just get bad advice. Okay, that's why you have to go to the appropriate person. Again, and that's why, yeah, did she get laughed at? Yes, but the laughter took away her anxiety. She wasn't humiliated by the Mother Prize. She was humbled. And so within this, if you have football questions, you go to the experts. You go to Bobby, you go to Jimbo. If you like this guy, you might go to him. Or maybe to him. Again, you might not like him, but you know he's an expert. You got basketball questions? I'm going to ask this guy. I'm going to ask the people who know the best. I'm not going to go and ask this guy. Okay? You go to the right person. And when you're having spiritual problems, go to the right person. And you'll know when you finally enter back into consolation. That's where a lot of people start making decisions and changing things, when they're not in a state of consolation. This is where well-versed is much better than well-intentioned. A person who's well-trained, and as well as a person who's experienced, this is why an older person, especially a parent, if you have a very good spiritual parent, if your parent hasn't been to Mass in 30 years, you probably don't want to go to them with spiritual questions, okay? But if you have actually a good parent, someone you can look up to, then yes, go to that person. Go to the person who you also know is going to be critical of you. That's why it can sometimes be helpful to go into your spouse, because your spouse will probably be critical. Okay, but that's where it can be actually helpful. Does this make sense? And so that's why you go to a person who's well-intentioned, or you go to a person, that's where I love what I hear all the time. And yeah, it's about 15 minutes too. So if you need to go to Mass or prepare for Mass, I understand. You can watch the rest of it online. So, but still, this is where I hear a lot of people like, well, I went and I heard the voice of God. I'm like, and all these other people have told you this. Where'd you hear from? Well, my friend, what is she? Buddhist. Okay? God can speak through Buddhists, most certainly. But in times of desolation, you probably don't want to listen to a person who is not very much attuned to the Holy Spirit. Does that make sense? And that's where, when people start listening to people who are not very well attuned to the Spirit, and that's why you have to go to the appropriate person. Now, can God speak? And I will tell you this, in times of consolation, God will most certainly speak through the Buddhist. He'll speak through the atheist. He'll speak through the Catholic. He'll speak through a dog. Okay, and actually to Balaam's ass in the Old Testament, God spoke through a donkey. Okay, God will speak in times of consolation, but in times of desolation, you have to be very careful who you trust. Especially if you find yourself in desolation, you have to be very careful who you're trusting. That's where people trust the wrong person and make very bad decisions. Does this make sense? So that's where looking at, what was this? You shed light into darkness. the darkness of anxiety, the darkness of confusion, the darkness of oppression. You open the door, allow the light to shine into that darkness. And what will actually happen is that if the evil one is present, you strip him of his advantage. Because darkness, which is ultimately, if you don't speak, it remains in darkness. If you speak it, it comes into light. Look back at Genesis. God spoke the word, light was separated from darkness. Light came about. Jesus came as the light of the world. You strip the enemy, because the enemy, when he's revealed, becomes very, very unappealing. Because when you really look at, and even talking about some of the things that we're the most shameful about, when you really look at those things and you speak them aloud to another person, it loses actually most of its appeal. All of a sudden you start realizing how this is not appealing whatsoever. Like in the moment it seemed really appealing. I didn't really like it then, and now it's even less appealing. Actually, you start talking about these things, you start processing them, you bring them out, and actually it loses all of its appeal because actually it's a mess, that this is not, and you find yourself free of the lies. It's why in confession, it's one of the primary ways in which we experience freedom. Freedom from the attacks of the enemy. Which leads us into number 14, and this is our final one. The enemy behaves as a chief bent on conquering and robbing what he desires, as a captain in chief of the army pitching his tent, looking at the forces and defenses of a stronghold, attacks it on the weakest side. In the like manner, the enemy of human nature roams about looking in turn at all of our virtues, theological, cardinal, and moral. Just curious, and just ask yourself a question, because until recently I didn't know all these. Do you know what these three levels of virtues are? If you don't, you might want to look them up, because it's important to know where we're weak. Are you weak in your cardinal virtues, faith, hope, and love? Are you weak in your theological virtues? Theological is faith, hope, and love. In your cardinal virtues, prudence, temperance, justice, and fortitude? Or are you in your moral virtues, your moral life and things of this nature? So, well, wherever you find yourself weakest is where you're going to be attacked. Where he finds us weakest, most in need of our eternal salvation, there he attacks us and aims at taking us. So what does this mean? That he, like an enemy general, will look at you. He will evaluate you. And this is where I love Lord of the Rings, because it shows this. Like any decent general, he has a battle plan that you are dealing with a very intelligent being, and he's not going to attack the front gates. If you have no problem with greed, and you're a pretty generous person, you're probably not going to get hit on a level of greed. You're not going to have opportunities for greed and things like that. But what might come to you is that you might have that cupcake just sitting right there. Or you might have that next drink. It might be gluttony. But that's your problem. If your problem is not pride, you're actually a pretty humble person. You desire growth and knowledge. You're actually willing to admit your mistakes. But yet you have pains and things from the past, family problems and things like that, emotional difficulties. You might struggle with looking at other people and evaluating your relationships compared to their relationships, looking at all the things this person has more and it doesn't seem to be fair. You might not get hit on a level of pride. You might be beginning to hit on a level of envy. Does this make sense? So you got to know where your weaknesses are, which is also, you need to know where your traumas are, and you need to know where your pains are. Many people who run away from their own personal pains and never look at them don't realize that that is where they're going to get hit by the enemy over and over and over and over and over and over and over until he beats you and takes you. Again, and he's obnoxious, just like my words just were. But he will hit you over because he's not going to assault you at your strongest. Because all of us, in my opinion, this is kind of my own personal opinion, but I think that all of us, in terms of especially our cardinal virtues, that we're blessed in two of them, and we're usually really weak in two. So you might be really good in prudence and really good with temperance, but you might really be bad with the justice, the knowing the blacks and whites, as well as sticking to it, fortitude. Or you might know you're black. You might know the catechism, know God's commandments, know the scriptures in and out. So you know the black and whites, but you just can't see how to apply it. You might, be constantly making stupid and doing stupid things. Prudence. Wherever your particular weakness is, that's where you will be hit. And that's the main point. That's why there's a certain level of personal authenticity as well as certain honesty with ourselves, recognizing where we are weak. This is why the sacrament of confession can be so helpful, because the enemy will study you. Sometimes I think that people think like the enemy is able to understand you as well as God does. He doesn't. The enemy doesn't. But he is, again, he's very good with numbers. He's very good with statistics. He's very good to see, okay, well, it's sort of like a little, little manipulative brother. He sees what buttons he can push. As long as he sees the button that he can push on you, he's going to keep pushing that little button over and over and over again. That's the enemy. So within that, he will study you and see where you are weakest, and wherever you are weakest, that's where he will try to make it blow up, striking you repeatedly and hard, unless you consistently push him back. But therefore, it's oftentimes in our weaknesses that we, and weaknesses, a lot of people think, well, therefore weaknesses are evil. Weaknesses are not bad, but he will try to blow you apart by hitting that weakness. A weakness is actually a point of beauty. If you look at even things like the Notre Dame or the great basilicas of Europe, the flying buttress is actually a beautiful thing, but it's actually meant, it was designed to support a weakness. And in this weakness, we find great beauty. If you had no weaknesses, you would have no need for other people, and you would find yourself isolated and alone. In our weaknesses, we find community and our need for people, our need for God, and things like this. Again, weakness is a support, makes something more beautiful, and we, naturally speaking, are incomplete. God made us in a state of being incomplete. Adam is incomplete without Eve. Eve is incomplete without Adam. They need each other. Men need women. Women need men. Families need each other. And so within our weaknesses, even on a fundamental human level, we are, naturally speaking, we're designed as being weak. And this is not a flaw. This is actually part of the design. This is what St. Paul comes to realize and recognize. He says, in my weaknesses, I am strong, because in my weaknesses, I find the face of God. It's actually in some of the most profound moments where you will experience God's love and presence in your life is if you abandon yourself, dive into your weaknesses, and ask why, and then you will find the face of God. People who run away from their weaknesses and can't admit to their weaknesses, can't admit that they have problems, are people who oftentimes will struggle with finding God. Because what? Pride. A person who falls into pride will fall away from God. Does this make sense? But actually, when you find in your weaknesses, you find the one who loves you, is that you are naturally completed by God and with others. So weaknesses do become strengths if we naturally fill that void with God. That's why the sacraments, that's why prayer, that's why community, and that's why all the ways in which God speaks to us in the world, and that's why consolation is so helpful, because in this we can actually find that a true awareness of our weaknesses. So some people have a weakness with initiative, and if you have a problem with initiative, then you probably will get hit here. Other, again, which will mean that laziness is what you might struggle with, which is why what you need to be aware of is that you need discipline. And people who struggle with laziness need order. They need a structure. They need a calendar. And sometimes it's a very simple fix. Just by what? By having a Google Calendar. For me, that's one of mine because I'm very disorganized. I have to have my Google Calendar because I didn't like it because I found it constricting and confining, because I also am fairly creative and I don't like the confines at places. But ultimately, if I didn't have any order, I'd never show up for anything, most especially 6:45 a.m. Mass. Okay? So I know where I'm weak. Okay, and I also, hopefully, I don't have much of a problem talking about it. Gratification. Some people, what, just desire, what, love, the gratification, the experience of that. But this is, again, can be a weakness, which is also why gratification is solved by fasting, by temperance, by balance, by not totally cutting it out and eliminating it, but by finding balance as opposed to just overindulgence. Another weakness that people have is in terms of intimacy, their interpersonal relationships, the deepest relationships, and this can be on the level of family or obviously on the level of our love life, but that's where looking at what is an authentic sexual expression versus what is just a quick grab, which is always what lust is a quick grab, a quick fix, but actually leaves you feeling very lonely, if that makes sense. Lust always makes you feel lonely because you're never known. The person knows your body, they don't know your heart. Person knows this, but it actually increases, lust will always increase the sense of loneliness. All forms of lust will increase loneliness in some fashion or form. So when looking at it, but again, it's not just that, you can also have problems with identity, who you are, where you find your identity, which is why people, especially with traumas from childhood and things like that, and have real deep personal things, can have problems with self-identity. That's a weakness, which if you find your identity in God, you will find yourself very strong. A person who flees from God will find themselves very, very weak and leading into especially sins of pride and envy. Versus the person who has that and they enter into prayer of adoration, blocks of time and thanksgiving, gratitude throughout the day, focusing upon where their identity comes from, will actually find themselves very quickly filling up. And finally, stability. When we have difficulties, again, from even the family unit and stability and things like this will be a weakness, because stability, people who try and are weak in the sense of stability will oftentimes rely upon control. Greed is very oftentimes connected to control.
Because in greed, we want to control our external environment. Because we don't want, because everything is unstable, uncertain. So money thinks that we think that with money we can control things. And that's why if you find yourself struggling with control and greed and things like this, the importance of giving away, of generosity. You fight it with the appropriate response. That's why if you come to me for confession, you might get some very strange confessions on the surface level. You might think, "What? I don't even understand what that is about." It's usually because I'm going after, and a good confessor is going after and trying to give you the appropriate penance to replace it. Not just to make up for your sins, but to replace it with something which actually will satisfy. Does that make sense? That's why delving into even our sins and delving into things like this in prayer is actually helpful, because you're like, "Lord, what is the good thing that I actually want?" Because God wants to satisfy that. It's the manner in which we find the satisfaction, which it is. If you have with knowledge, or the lack of knowledge, St. John Paul II said this, "So even stupidity is a gift from God, but it's a gift which should not be overindulged in." Or if you have a great desire for knowledge, again, then the question is, do we listen? Because a person who is with anger is always an indication that you don't know things well enough. For instance, when I get angry in the car, it's because I think I understand the whole way the world works. No, there's other people in the world who are also going to their places of work. It's not all about me. So, when you are aware of your weaknesses and find support in God, you can strip the enemy of actually his primary tool of attack, which is actually that your weaknesses no longer lead you into sin. Your weaknesses lead you into an encounter with God. And actually praying specifically about weaknesses, as opposed to just telling God what we think we want him to hear, but actually entering in and bringing our weaknesses and actually delving into them, diving into them, asking God about them, asking God to help us understand these weaknesses, which oftentimes evolve into sins, is actually a beautiful type of prayer. It's very difficult. It can be very painful, but it actually is very freeing. Does this make sense? And in that, you strip the enemy of his ability to manipulate your choices. You strip him of his ability, because it's actually in this, by a person who is unaware of their weakness or likewise denies their weakness. But if they embrace and recognize their weakness, you strip the enemy of its primary tool of attack, which is taking advantage of your ignorance. It's what he does to Adam and Eve in the garden. Enemy has new tactics, just the same garbage over and over and over. If you think that's the wonderful thing also about dealing with the enemy, is that you're never going to have to worry about him coming up with a new tactic. He's perfect. He doesn't know anything more than he already knows. He knows everything, which also means he's not creative. You're only going to get sick. That's what my grandfather used to say. He said, every heresy is only a regurgitation of some old heresy. He said, every sin is only just a regurgitation of one of the seven primal ones. The devil doesn't come up with anything new. But once you understand his tactics, once you understand the tactics of the entirety of the enemy, both the flesh, the world, and Satan, actually you can find yourself very quickly being able to recognize it, but that's only if you're aware, but recognize it with knowledge, and then you reject the things which are of the enemy, and you accept the things from God. So I know that we've got 5 minutes until Mass starts for some of you, so I'm going to go ahead and close with a prayer. I'm going to open up for questions, and I'll stay here for a little bit because I don't have the Mass. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time to come together tonight. Just ask you, Lord, to send the Spirit more fully into our lives. Give us a spirit of understanding, of knowledge, so we can make right judgments, so that we may be truly wise, that we may have the proper and the healthy expressions of love, which we call piety. We just ask you, Lord, to send down the 7 gifts of the Spirit in abundance and upon all those who are present here. Help us to see how you are speaking and moving in our lives, interacting with us, even in the ways in which we don't always understand or see. Help us to have a greater awareness of where you are speaking to us, guiding us, and help us to have the knowledge and awareness to see where we are called into spiritual warfare, to reject the things of the enemy, and to accept the blessings which come from you. And we ask all this in the words which Christ himself gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Go in the peace of Christ, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.